excerpt from Jesus Christ Superstar to get us in the mood for Palm Sunday. We're going to start with a song about the majesty of Jesus expressed in humble terms, meekness and majesty. Please join in, just two verses. Loving God, we join this day in glad and joyful praise. We welcome Christ once more as our King, Lord, and Saviour. We promise him our loyalty. We bring him our love. We bow to him in worship. We greet him with wonder. Hosanna to the Son of David, glory in the highest heaven. Gracious God, as we remember this day how Jesus entered Jerusalem to cries of celebration, help us to welcome him afresh into our own hearts and lives. Accept the praise and worship we bring you, and give us a real sense of expectation as we look towards his coming kingdom. Hosanna to the Son of David, glory in the highest heaven. Gracious God, like your people long ago, we do not always see clearly, our faith shallow and self-centered. We do not understand as we should, our praise short-lived and superficial. But we ask, take the faith we offer, weak though it may be, and deepen it through this day, through this coming Holy Week, that we may truly welcome Christ as our King and worship him with joyful praises now and always. Hosanna to the Son of David, glory in the highest heaven, now and always. Amen. It is Palm Sunday, and many of you will still have perhaps the palm crosses left over from last year. I have mine just here, propped up in a book, just as a reminder of this special day. If my face keeps changing colour, by the way, don't panic. It's something to do with the sun going in and out, and I have no control over that. We're going to hear the story of the first Palm Sunday as told to us by Matthew. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21, verses 1 to 11. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village ahead of you. And immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately. This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven! When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, who is this? The crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. Thanks be to God. One of my favourite quiz programmes on television at the moment is called Only Connect, in which you have to try and find connections between four apparently random clues. Well, I'm going to set you a little puzzle today. You will see here appearing on the side of the screen four random clues. What's the connection between them? Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 to 11. Matthew 27, verses 50 and 51. Matthew 28, verses 1 to 2. And a seismograph. Now, I know that is an unfair question because unless you've got a really good understanding of the Bible and a very good memory, you won't know what two of those references mean. If you are paying attention, you will, I hope, recognise the first one, Matthew 21, as the story of Palm Sunday, which you've just heard and should still be fresh in your memory. But what about the other two? Well, to be fair to you, let's tell you what they are. Matthew 27, verses 50 and 51. Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. Verse chapter 28, verses 1 and 2. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. Okay, you might now be thinking you spot the connection. It's about earthquakes. The last clue, seismograph, that is a machine for measuring earthquakes. But the actual connection's a little stronger than that. It's all about the Greek word, seismos. And the verb means to shake or to move to and fro or to agitate. The noun means a shaking or a commotion or an earthquake. And it's that Greek word which connects these four items. Seismograph is named after the Greek for the shaking, the quaking that you get in an earthquake. And I hope you noticed the previous two that I just read out. When Jesus died on the cross, this was not just an ordinary everyday event, tragic though it was. This was not just a criminal dying on a cross, which happened frequently in those times, I'm sad to say. This was the Son of God dying on the cross for our sakes. This was a momentous event, and Matthew describes that in terms of the ground was shaken. And then the resurrection, the moment when Jesus conquered death, not just returning back to life like people like Lazarus and one or two others who were restored to life, but Jesus conquered death, never to die again. He rose from the grave and he triumphed over death. And that, again, is a momentous event in which Matthew describes an earthquake shaking everything. By now, you might be thinking, okay, we get the earthquake connection between the last three, but that first one, the story of Palm Sunday, where was the earthquake in that? Well, it wasn't described as an earthquake in the version I read. Let me remind you again of the key verse. It comes at the end. When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, who is this? Now, if you turn to the Greek for that, the whole city in turmoil, literally it means the whole city was shaken. And it's exactly the same Greek word as on Good Friday when the ground was shaken. The same word, the same shaking, the same dramatic moment. Of course, on Palm Sunday, we are talking metaphorically. This isn't Matthew telling us that there was an earthquake on Palm Sunday, but the people were shaken. Something was going on. What was it? It was as if God had taken that city and rattled it to its core. What was happening? Why do we shake people? Well, we might shake someone gently in order to wake them up. Or if they're hysterical, we might grab their shoulders and shake them more violently and perhaps even slap them a couple of times across the face. This is not good medical advice. This is probably very bad medical advice. Don't do it. But when we see television, when we see things on film, this is what they do. If you want to stop someone who's having hysterics, give them a good shake. Shaking is a way of saying, wake up, pay attention. And maybe this is what God was doing to the city. He was wanting them to pay attention to what's going on. You can see that on Good Friday, something really dramatic happened when Jesus died. You can see it on Easter Sunday. Dramatic events again, death conquered. But why Palm Sunday? What was so dramatic about that? It was the start of the week. It wasn't the big momentous events at the end. Why were the people shaken then? They were shaken because something dramatic was happening. The Messiah was coming into the city and he was not the kind of Messiah that they were expecting. They welcomed him as the Son of David. That's a messianic title. They knew who this was. Jesus, the Son of David. This is the Messiah that they were welcoming, but not the warrior king, not the one who would overthrow the Romans, the humble servant, the one coming riding on a donkey. That was what was so surprising. That was what was so shocking. That was what God was trying to get people to pay attention to. It's as if God was saying, look, I'm going to work this way now. I'm going to work humbly. I'm going to work through sacrifice, through death and resurrection. That's my way, not the way of the conquering hero, like the mighty warriors of the past. This is the work of the Messiah, the humble servant. That's the way God is going to work. That's the way he expects us to work. I know at the moment, humble service is difficult. Loving our neighbour has to be through telephones, through conversations at a distance, and often there's a little we can do in terms of practical help. But the way of Jesus is still a way for us to follow. We are in a time of crisis, and it's as if the whole world is being shaken at the moment. Whether this is a wake-up call to the world, well, time will tell. And if it is, waking up to what? Are we waking up to stronger communities, to better international cooperation, to supporting and taking seriously our health service? I don't know. These are all important issues, and maybe out of what's happening now will come something that will help in unimaginable ways. At the moment, all we can do is trust God that this may only be the start of something that still needs to shake us, and dramatic changes still to come. But if we trust God, there will be changes for good, and resurrection will follow death. In the meantime, we may not be allowed to go out and join a crowd. We may not even be allowed to travel unnecessary journeys, whether on a donkey or any other mode of transport. But we can this week walk the path of humble service and sacrificial love as we follow the path of Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we pray today for those we love. We pray for those who we cannot see in the flesh, but we still care about very much. For safety, for good health, we pray. We pray, Lord, for those who are in need of comfort, those living alone, those who are elderly or frail, those who are ill and have no one to care for them. Give them strength and hope. We pray for those in need of practical help, those who need food, those who need medical care. And we pray for those who are seeking to provide these things. May they do so well and efficiently, and may help reach those most in need. We pray, Lord, for unity in this world. We ask that you would help the leaders of the world now to focus on what matters most, to put aside differences, intolerance and injustice, to work together for the good of all. And we pray, Lord, for one another, that even in these hard times you will help us to walk in the way of Christ, in humble service, with sacrificial love. We ask all these prayers in his name. Amen. And please join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Keep your mind fixed on Christ, your heart on his glory, your eyes on his purpose, and your ears on his voice. Be filled with the Spirit as people of God. Amen. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen.